Hello, and welcome to the Inside EVs podcast for October the 9th, 2020. This is episode number 27. Today, we'll be talking about the Tesla Model 3 getting a refresh, driving the Volkswagen ID4, the Polestar 2 is facing a total recall. I'm Dominic Ioni, Inside EVs editor and Inside EVs forum moderator. Joining us today, we have Tom Malogny, longtime and multiple EV owner and Inside EVs editor. We also have Martin Lee from the EV News Daily podcast, available on all your usual podcast platforms. And of course, we have Kyle Connor from the Out of Spec Motoring and One Lap YouTube channels. He also puts together the super awesome videos for the new Inside EVs YouTube channel. Go subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications. So, welcome, gentlemen of the panel and ladies and gentlemen of the audience. Okay, so to start off, I wanted to let you all know about a new series of videos that we're doing. As many of you already know, we've been doing this 70-mile-an-hour range test. And since those tests typically end at a charging station with a completely empty battery, it makes sense then to film the charging process and keep track of the time and the cost for all of these different cars that we're driving. So we published our first one earlier this week. It's called Time to Charge. Our first contestant was the 2020 Nissan Leaf Plus. Now, if you don't want to go, I don't want to go into a lot of detail about that, about this particular car, but even though it was particularly uncooperative, but you can find it on the Inside EVs YouTube channel. Instead, Kyle, do you want to tell us a little bit more about this new series?
Yeah, that'd be great. So this new series is all about finding a new metric to base EVs on that currently is not in the market. So you can see a lot of manufacturers and people talk about peak charging rates. Oh, this Taycan does 270 kilowatt or the Nissan Leaf can do 104 kilowatt, whatever it is. But what really matters is how long it can sustain good charging speeds. That's why sort of the Audi e-tron looks a little lackluster at 150 kilowatt peak, but it can retain that all the way to 74% or 78%. And so this is really going to show what an optimal charging session with a warmed up car and a charger that can deliver max output from 0 to 95%+. Sometimes it doesn't make sense to go all the way to 100, but at least 95-ish%. And that way we can just analyze the curves. Of course, we could ask manufacturers for their data. We could go to FastNed supplied data, but it's really good to do real world tests for us. And then what we'll have is some of our editors or presenters talking over the charging curve and explaining why the car is doing X number of speed at this particular time. I like to compare the in-car screen. Some cars don't show you how much power it's taking at a time, but if it does, we definitely will record that and compare it to the charging delivered, because that will show losses throughout the entire charging session like you're seeing right here.
Right on. And hey, Tom, I guess you have you did one of these videos this week too. I believe we have that up this morning, the BMW i3S with a range extender.
Yeah, so we did a 2020 BMW i3S where I drove it down to 6%. That's where the range extender turns on. You can't take the i3 with range extender down to zero like you can a full battery electric i3. So we had to start at 6%. And BMW says that the car takes 40 minutes to go to 80%. And it took me 39 minutes and 58 seconds to go to 80%. So I beat it by 2 seconds. I think the fact that it was a wreck starting at 6%, it should have finished up a little earlier. But this car was sitting out overnight. It was about 50 degrees. So the battery was cold and immediately took it to the charging station. So between the cold battery and then the lower voltage of a drain battery, we only started at 42 kilowatts instead of the 50 that the i3 can take. So it gradually ramped up and had a great charging curve. One thing about the i3, it does have the battery's not huge. It's only a 42 kilowatt hour battery. It only charges at 50 kilowatts, but BMW has fantastic charging curves. The Mini Cooper SE does the same thing. It just, when you plug it in, it's at like 90% of its maximum rate, and then it just keeps raising all the way up till it'll hold the maximum charge rate, the i3, until 87% full, which is really what Kyle was talking about before. Many of the EVs we see after like 50%, they start tapering down. But the i3 does a great job. Yeah, we have the FastNed chart up there. And that's with the three different battery packs. The smallest battery pack had the earliest ramp down. It started ramping down, I think, right after 60%. But now, once BMW increased it to the 33 kilowatt hour pack, it made the charging curve better. And now with the 42 kilowatt hour pack, it does even better. So while it's a small battery EV that doesn't go very far per charge, BMW has a very good charging curve on the vehicle. So it does recharge very quickly.
Nice. Hey, so while we're on the topic of DC fast charging, I understand that you had some stats that you wanted to share with us about cost and how you think they aren't maybe that important, Kyle.
Yeah, well, actually, before we get into that, let's talk about our i3. So we own an i3. It's our third one. We love them. They're amazing cars. Tom's had a few as well. They're very cool. The one that we have now is a 22 kilowatt hour tiny battery pack one. And it is doing something so frustrating on DC chargers. Of course, it's a wreck, so we don't DC charge it very much. We just run the gas engine and go where we need to go on longer trips, but it very infrequently does that. But it is going and tapering down to like 1 or 2 kilowatt by the time we're at 80%. Like it rips 50 kilowatt all the way through to 60% to its normal taper, and then it's just like falls off a ledge way harder than the graphs show that it should. Now, the car's low mileage. It's probably not been DC charged much. The battery capacity is really holding up quite well. We've done some tests with it. And so I can't figure out why it's tapering so hard. It's been doing it on multiple sessions with the car at optimal temperatures and can't figure it out. Also, another tip for Tom, next time you run an i3, it's super annoying. But if you run the gas engine out, you can drain the battery all the way. And so that way it'll stop at zero. But, you know, you're right on the edge of running out of juice right there.
So let me comment. I had thought about doing that, but this was a friend's car. It wasn't a media car. A friend has a brand new 2020, you know, i3S Rex. I didn't want to he might view that as abuse if I ran it down till the thing shut off. And like, this is his personal car. So yeah. Unfortunately, I couldn't do that. Yeah. Yeah. Chris's a good guy. So, I don't think he would have appreciated that. So yeah, I know my boundaries.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically, we have a whole bunch of cool cars coming in this test from iPace, e-tron, Taycan, all the Teslas. So keep your eye on the Inside EVs US YouTube channel that you're hopefully watching this podcast on. Now I want to talk about DC charging costs and how much of a role this plays into your total cost of ownership on your electric car. And before we start running numbers and calculations on this, because I think it's an important topic and one that's super heated, especially in the world of Twitter, I wanted to approach our podcast listeners first and ask, how do you DC charge your car? Do you use it once a month, twice a month? Basically, if you can comment in the comments with roughly how many kilowatt hours you take from a DC charging session on a monthly average, that would be cool. So like for me, it's right around 1 megawatt hour plus because I road trip a ton. So I'm definitely on the very high side. And then for others, it might be 30 kilowatt hours or 50 kilowatt hours with one charging session. So that'd be interesting to know because especially in my local region, we have three main charging providers. We have EVgo, ChargePoint, and Electrify America, and each have taken a different pricing strategy within our own state. EVgo, for example, makes you pay an activation fee. Sometimes it's like $5, and then they charge you 28 cents a minute for a 100 amp, 50 kilowatt, quote unquote, charging session. Then Electrify America is now charging by the kilowatt hour in my state. But if I go up one exit, it's by the minute. And in some cars, I can save as much as 80% on my charging costs just by driving 15 minutes up the highway to Virginia. So I'm curious to see how you all will use this. And I'd like to put together like a comprehensive, here's how much it would cost to charge a car on the Inside EV site. So we'll work with Tom on that. Tom, what do you think? Do you think charging DC charging costs is a huge consideration? Of course, it's not supposed to be used very often, What are your thoughts?
Well, if you don't have access to charging at home, then yeah, you're going to use it very often, Kyle. You have to remember, we're kind of spoiled. We can charge at home. Many of us can charge at home and at work. But when EVs really start to proliferate and the general public, you know, we go beyond early adopters to the majority, then a lot of people live in public in housing that they can't charge at home. So we have to be cognizant of that. And we can't expect them to pay, you know, 10 times more than what we pay at home. So, yeah, I have mixed feelings on this as well. You guys know that I own charging stations in Montclair, New Jersey on my property. So I manage a DC fast charger I lose a few hundred dollars a month on that because with demand charges, the electricity is so expensive. So I understand why the providers in many cases charge a lot of money because they, you know, they're saying, look, you know, we're not going to be profitable, but we have to at least cut our losses until adoption increases, until, you know, the utilization of these charging stations are very high. All the network providers right now are losing tons of money. Nobody's making money on DC fast charge. And I think that this is going to work itself out. I think that it's going to be the Wild West for a few years, but I'm thinking maybe by 2025-ish, there'll be kind of consistent pricing. It won't be exactly the same from EVgo to Electrify America to ChargePoint, but I think what we're going to see is the industry streamline and move towards a fair charging where most of the networks are kind of consistent. But in the meantime, it's going to be Wild West. And I know the public is going to all say, listen, charge us by the kilowatt hour. That's the most fair way to do this. And I lean towards that, but I also understand why the time-based charging is so important. Like you with your i3, you know, you plug it in, you're at a DC fast charger, and look at what you're charging. What happens to your charging curve after 80%? It drops off. You're actually charging slower than what you could charge on a level 2 charging station. Meanwhile, you're hogging that charger for like a half an hour or so, and I pull up in my e-tron and I want to plug in, but you're sucking down 1 kilowatt, you know, and I'm sitting there waiting now for half an hour because, you know, you're saying I'm not leaving until I'm 100%. So I think there needs to be some sort of a time-based incentive. I don't have the full answer, but I think both things have to be considered. And I think we'll get there, but I think it's going to be 4 or 5 more years before we get there.
I think part of the answer will come with cities, municipalities putting in street side charging, like low speed, not fast speed charging, just like AC, like what do I have? Like 8 to 12 amps, you know, 110 volts. Just trickle charging, but I mean that's what I use at home. That's all I ever need to have, you know, plenty. So, but if people, street parkers, could have that convenience, because we already have electricity running, right, you know, right along underneath most streets, because you know the street lamps have to be powered, and actually in some places they have street lamps that have outlets that you can plug into as well. So, I think that would really take the pressure off of DC fast charging for people who don't have the convenience of a garage or a parking lot that they can charge up at home. Yeah. But one of the frustrating things for me, just to throw this out there, you were talking about the BMW being frustrated to charge. I tried to fast charge my Spark EV this week again at the local Electrify America station. And yeah, struck out again. This is my third or fourth attempt to fast charge. But this time, like, it didn't work the first time. I just got the spinning, you know, the screen. But then the second time, something happened. Like, the machine started making, the fans came on, and the car, I heard a little contactor click inside the car, and I was about to get excited. But then the screen said, my charging session has ended. Just, it never even really began. But it, yeah, anyway. I just thought I'd update that little thing. If you have a Spark EV, charging at Electrify America stations is not necessarily going to work for you. But yeah. So, anything else to say about the DC fast charging, Arthur?
I tested an interesting car yesterday that has DC fast charging, but is also a hybrid.
We're going to talk about
that. Thought the Mitsubishi, cool. I just thought it was interesting to talk about the curves of plug-in hybrids Does it matter? This is another question for the comments. Does the DC charging curve on a plug-in hybrid that's primarily gas-powered matter?
Right.
Leave your thoughts below.
All right. Well, let's hit a news story real quick then. So there were rumors that the Tesla Model 3 is about to get a refresh of sorts. So we don't expect to see any changes to the bodywork, but Electric was reporting yesterday that they have a source inside that says there's a number of changes coming. And this morning we have a post up on Inside EVs. And actually we have some pictures. A Twitter user, a whole Mars catalog, had posted some pictures of this new Model 3, slightly refreshed Model 3. So the bodywork is all the same. But there's some small changes. There's like chrome delete on the doors and door handles and the window trim, etc. And it could be getting an updated frunk and a powered trunk. Moving to the inside, there's a new console, and you can see that in the pictures on our site. There's a new center console. So gone is the piano black and the fingerprint magnet. It should be replaced by a... And that's like a three-piece thing, that whole center console. It goes in like three pieces. I think what's replacing it is like a two-piece construction thing, and it has a matte finish. And also the area where the phone chargers are is a little different. Instead of being covered by a door that flips open, it will have a sliding cover. And you can see in the picture here on your screen if you're watching this on YouTube. Yeah. I believe this is a vehicle headed for Japan, so hence the... steering wheel is on the other side of the car. And I believe someone said the steering wheel cover material is changed. I believe the roof liner might be also changed with a slightly darker material. And I believe on Twitter, someone had said that center screen. I don't know if you guys can see the center screen there. If you think, does that look the same to you as what's in your cars? Yeah? Okay. So... Besides that, let's see. So more importantly, I guess on the Electric article, they said that it was also getting new double pane glass that will help make the cabin quieter. There were other rumors as well that it was going to get the so-called octavalve and heat pump that you found in the Model Y. But I've seen different opinions about that online this morning. Tom, what do you think of these changes? Are you ready to trade in yours for a new one? These are rolling off the line now.
I think I'll keep my 2019. I'm not surprised. You know, it's not that unusual. The Model 3 now has been available for what, 2.5 years? So it's not that unusual for a manufacturer to make some small changes, you know, 2 or 3 years into production. I mean, it would have been, you know, very surprising if they changed anything on the outside that was really, you know, where they had to retool for it. So, you know, I'm not too surprised about this. Until we see what it is, it's hard to really comment, but mine is fine the way it is. I'd be more interested in hearing that if they're upgrading the heating system to the, you know, that the octo-valve and things that might make the vehicle more efficient rather than just, you know, a redesigned center console. That's, you know, right. No big deal. And for me, I put in the automatic, the opening trunk and frunk that's available at Evernex. So, you know, for me, it didn't seem like it's much of a difference and not really kind of like a non-story. I mean, everything with Tesla is a story, but, you know, it's just normal operating procedures, do little upgrades here and there.
Sure. I think the headlights actually changed too, but not the outside so much, but I think they like the bulbs inside. I think there's some slight differences there as well. Kyle, what do you think about this? I think you're on mute.
Sorry about that. I was on mute. Basically, what do I think about this? It doesn't do anything. I mean, I don't know how we can consider this a refresh. It's you're changing a color, you're moving a panel, and that's it. It's not crazy exciting to me. I think I certainly hate the center storage in my car, the little flappy thing. So the slider is a welcome addition. Right. What else is there? A darker headliner would be amazing. I've been asking for this for a long time. Really? I've seen people aftermarket change to a darker headliner in their Model 3s, especially with the white seats. The gray headliner makes it look super weird and the colors don't work so well, in my opinion. And also on that picture that we had on the interior, it is possible that that dashboard looked to be a darker color. So this could be a black piece. It doesn't look like the lighter wood that goes with the black interior typically. But again, is it a refresh? No, it's just a color palette change. You know, we're not seeing any functional difference in terms of battery pack or design. So yeah, it doesn't really seem too exciting to me. I don't see any reason to upgrade to this, is I guess what I'm trying to say.
Right. I think the double pane glass is a big plus. I don't know. There's been a fair amount of complaints about that, about the noise levels.
I'm trying to think how much noise actually comes from the window side on my car. And I think I have a bit of wind noise on this one just because the seal doesn't match the window so well. Tesla build quality. It's been in twice for them to fix it. They can't fix it. But also, you know, on my last 2018 rear wheel drive, which was a very early production Model 3, it was a flawless build, like literally nothing wrong with it. And it was really quiet on the inside. And most of the noise was coming from the top glass, not the double pane on the side, or not the single pane. So how much of a difference will it make? We'll see. I'd be really surprised if they do this to Model 3 with this double pane glass and not to Model S or X, because that just separates their flagship cars being so far behind their current, you know, everyday offerings.
That's true. Martin, you have some thoughts. So actually, just mentioning your quality thing, we were thinking maybe next week talking a little bit more about Tesla quality. So if you're like a hardcore Tesla fan, you don't want to hear anything bad about the brand, don't tune in next week because... we might be bringing up a few sensitive subjects. So, but anyway, Martin, what do you think? Is this refresh is a little bit too much in your mind as well?
It's the constant battle or a line that they have to kind of work out at Tesla, isn't it? Where they've got some very expensive cars that in some people's minds are using older technology, although even though the form factor of the cells is the original ones, the chemistry inside has changed, but you know, largely the Model Y is the latest greatest car, and so how do you continue to sell Model 3s when the Model Y has all the best latest stuff inside it? But it's like mobile phones or computers or anything, that there's always, the minute you buy anything with Tesla, there is a new latest greatest coming out. But what's cool about it is that they actually bother to go back and update the Model 3. So they could have, I guess the other option was plow forward with Model Y, focus on building new factories around the world. 3 is going to do what it does. But I think what's admirable here is they've taken the time and the engineering time and expense to say, you know what, let's redesign the front end of the 3 because they had to make the frunk smaller. Let's get that heat pump inside, if indeed it is. And let's keep that car as relevant as we possibly can. Again, the electric boot lift is, you know, and closing is not a deal breaker for me. I've never had that on any car that I've owned. And I know that some people swear by it. Some people, you know, can't imagine touching it and actually having to lift it up. Whereas it's not a big hardship for me. But, you know, again, that's important to some people. The glass is the big unknown. I'm not sure about that. But the other things that we can see in the pictures all make sense. Not being a Model 3 owner myself, all I can take from all of my friends that have got Model 3s is that I've never met a single person who likes that high gloss finish inside. And I'm just surprised it took them so long to change it, or at least, you know, it's been good for the aftermarket websites and friends of ours who provide those solutions, because it just had zero fans by the look of it. It scratched on day one. So hey, no, all good. I saw the right-hand drive. I was hopeful it was UK, but maybe it's Japan that it's going to. And there's still a steady... there was a big end of quarter push over here. So now we're into the new quarter. I'm not sure how many ships are arriving, but there was a big September push from Tesla, here in the UK at least, with those right-hand drive models. So yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing if anyone who's watching in the UK takes delivery in the next few weeks from the next shipment. Is it updated in right-hand drive? Also interesting that it is right-hand drive. Normally in sort of the left-hand drive markets, you would think would be prioritized for those changes. So... hey, I'm not going to try and second guess it. It's great news.
All right. Yeah, I think this of all these things, I think the heat pump is probably the most interesting, just because it might give you a little bit more range, or might make the whole, you know, heating situation a little bit better, make the car a bit more efficient. But hey, while we're talking about Tesla, Elon also said yesterday on Twitter that phantom braking should be fixed in this latest wider release. Now, I don't know if he's talking about a release that's already happened or one that's about to come up, that's just coming up, but any of you Tesla owners noticed the difference yet? And maybe say what, explain really quickly what phantom braking is. Maybe Kyle.
Yeah. Kyle, why don't you start out?
Sure thing. Okay, phantom braking is a phenomena that happens on any car with driver assistance systems up to this point that relies on a radar system or a vision or combined. And what it is it's the car thinking it's seeing something that's not there. For example, it's very difficult for a car to see an overpass. I'm not saying it only happens on overpasses, but this is one example. And then say, is that overpass high enough for me to travel through, or is the shadow all the way down and it's just a brick wall I'm barreling towards? And it's very difficult for the car to discern street signs, cars parked on shoulders. And so up to this point, it's been this compromise in the engineering of the software that they've had to say, okay, how safe do we want the system to be, i.e. slowing down for everything that could potentially be in its path, versus will people actually use it for customer experience, i.e. we're just going to go until the probability of an impact reaches a certain threshold and then we'll brake. And once the car brakes really hard for an object that it believes is in your path, that's called phantom braking. And these are not just light taps on the brake. This is full into ABS, emergency brakes, out of the blue. I mean, it even happens sometimes. Like, I had an older Porsche with just radar cruise control. It's not unique to Tesla, and it's happened on many other cars, but this was back in 2010. And that car would just randomly pop up with the front collision warning, like I'm going to barrel into something, but there was nothing around. So it's not unique to Tesla. What they are going to do to fix it in this new release, I don't know. Really, the biggest thing is what it needs is object recognition and then some sort of AI on the back end to say, okay, this is looks like a street sign, it is likely that it's not in the middle of the road. And that's probably what they're going to start doing is object recognition of common objects that the car typically phantom brakes for, whether it's lighting conditions or objects around the road. I will say on the current software that's on my car, happens all the time still.
Okay.
So I have a little experience with this also. Before I even talk about Tesla, I'll say that my two BMW i3s experienced this also, but they reacted a little bit differently. When the i3 first came out in 2014, what would happen was if I would approach an underpass where there was a dark shadow, like Kyle mentioned, it really happens when there's a dark shadow and the vehicle can't tell if it's an obstruction in the road or a shadow. What would the i3 used to do is just beep and disengage the adaptive cruise control. It didn't really brake, but it would just give a loud warning and shut the adaptive cruise control off, which was like a jarring jolt as you're driving all of a sudden. And what would happen was the car would go in full regen, which the i3 had really strong regen, at least a little bit stronger back when it was first released. I think BMW's toned it down over the years. So it would feel like you were under really hard braking. Now, BMW later on changed that. And when the adaptive cruise control dropped, it would free wheel coast for a second or so and then gradually increase the regen. So it wouldn't be such an abrupt, like as soon as it disengages, you're just, you know, full on braking. So it was a little different than what happened. So I'm just explaining that Tesla's not unique to this. It happens, as Kyle mentioned, in other systems too. When I first got my Model 3, it was pretty bad. I drive this one stretch of Route 80 in New Jersey where there's a lot of overpasses, and I'd be driving under them, and it would do that just momentarily for like a half a second. It would give a real hard break, and people behind me think that you're like brake checking them. And then it seemed to get better. And then as we had updates, it was getting better. Now we had the last update I had was about three or four weeks ago. It got worse. It's back to how it was in the beginning. And I have gotten comfortable on this one stretch of the highway where it wasn't occurring anymore. And then when I did the software update, the first time I was driving on that stretch, it I was going about 70, 75 miles an hour. I had it, you know, on autopilot, and it braked so hard. I had to look up from behind me. There was a pickup truck that almost rear-ended me. And luckily I just punched it. And now I am back to being on edge. Every time I approach an overpass with autopilot on, I'm ready. My foot's ready to just, you know, step on the accelerator if it checks. So this will be very welcome if they improve this, because it's actually dangerous the way it is right now. It's not safe.
Sure. Yeah.
It'll likely cause more accidents than it will save.
Right.
Kyle, have you noticed it getting worse at all recently? Or
yes, me and the dogs as well. They've noticed it very much.
Okay. It's funny.
I you know, it's brakes and then poof, they hit the back of my seat.
It's a hard brake. When you're when you're cruising at 70-75 miles an hour, Kyle's probably doing 85 miles an hour. You know, and all of a sudden, like, you know, your car just jams on the brakes. It's startling, you know.
I still think I'm going to go after Tesla for my warped brake rotors because of this, because, you know, it's never been on track before or driven hard. So this is the only explanation as to why my brake rotors are warped.
Just one interesting little data point. I was talking to somebody on Twitter yesterday. I believe his name is James Locke. I think I have that right. And he hasn't had any of that phantom braking at all. So it was kind of bizarre. I think he's a pretty reliable guy. I've been following him for years now. He's had, I think, a couple different Teslas. But yeah, he hasn't had any, travels a lot, but he hasn't had an issue with it. So it doesn't seem like it's a uniform thing, but enough people have been experiencing it.
I haven't driven a Tesla without it. I've been in every single model across all model years, AP1, they do it. I was just driving some random car. I forget what it was. It might've been a Volvo or something. And it does the same thing. It's not unique to Tesla. It's just, it requires object recognition because otherwise you run into situations where the cars plow into the side of semi trucks, like that Florida case where it went under the truck because you've tuned the system to be less sensitive to phantom braking when it's like, no, actually there's something there for the one time. So
It's an important system to get right. That's for sure. And while we're speaking about the Tesla autonomous capability driving, Elon Musk also mentioned yesterday that they have a zero intervention, full self-driving software coming. I think that's capable of zero intervention. That might not necessarily be everyone's experience, but that'll be rolling out to beta users at some time this year, I believe. So that's kind of neat.
That's the for anyone watching, that's a very important insight that Dom just gave there into Elon Musk's definition of feature complete. And he said this a couple of times, either at an AI conference or things recently, where he said in his head or his definition, or anyone's definition that he subscribes to of feature complete, is that it has a good chance of taking him from his house to work with zero interventions. Doesn't mean he can do it Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, and it happens every day, but it has a good chance of at least doing that journey with zero interventions. And so people hear that feature complete and think, great, I'm going to get a pizza, I'll have a nap, wake me up when I get there. And they don't understand this is his, like, that's what he means when he says it has a good chance of zero interventions. It just means that it's got a fair crack at it, not that it will do it every single journey. And as I've said before on this podcast, if my boss had a beta version of full self-driving, hell, I'd make sure that that route from his house to the office was a really, really well mapped out route. But they don't use mapping, so I'll leave it there.
True. Yeah, it's supposed to be able to go places where they have never been before. Are supposed to be able to handle terrain, you know, roads that it's never seen before. So that's the editor in chief of Moto One actually has full self-driving on his Tesla Model 3. And so we should be able to get some inside scoop on how that develops as it develops. But we should move on.
I also have access to a beta card that I'm able to film with. So as soon as it gets there, we'll be doing it. I'm not going to say who it is, obviously.
Don't tell us.
But we'll be sharing everything with it.
Yeah. Yet the summon feature still can't pull out of a parking space and drive up to you 50 feet away
without running six people over and crashing into curbs.
Right.
You're absolutely right, Tom.
I've never heard of it crashing the curb. Has it done that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's crashed. I just saw someone crash it in their garage the other day.
Oh, really?
It was like, I'm like, God, it's so bad, all of this stuff. And the fact that they're saying it's so good, it's not. Look, I use autopilot 99% of the time. It's not ready for prime time. So, you know, we're just going to see more people not paying attention at the wheel when they 100% need to be paying attention at all times when using driver assistance systems. They're not driver replacement systems yet, and they will not be for a while.
Right. Okay, well, so I understand that both you, Kyle, and Tom had some interesting drives this week. So let's start with Tom, since he drove what will probably be outsell the other one that you had by like 100,000 to one over the next few years. So Tom, tell us about the new Volkswagen ID4 all-electric crossover. Take it away.
Yeah, so we had a really, really rare opportunity to drive an ID4. There were only 20 people in the U.S. invited to do this early drive. So it was a really good score for us. They were having drives in New York City and in California. I'm here in New Jersey, so got to drive it in New York City, which is just about the worst place in the world to do a drive. But due to COVID restrictions, you know, Volkswagen couldn't have a regular media drive where they invite dozens and dozens of people and rent out a hotel and, you know, everybody comes and there's two people to a car and you get the car all day, sometimes 2 days. Instead, they had 1 hour blocks cut off and we only had access to the car 45 minutes of that 1 hour, because 15 minutes was then for them to completely sanitize the vehicle after each person got to drive it. So 45 minutes in the streets of New York is good enough to drive like 10 blocks. So unfortunately, I don't have as thorough a first drive report as I would like or as we normally can get. But I still had a good amount of time and experience in the car to get a feel for what it is. So, you know, the first thing that I will say is that the car feels huge inside. It has a tremendous amount of passenger space, and that's because of the MEB platform, and Volkswagen really pushed the passenger to car compartment up as far to the front of the vehicle as they could. Now, the sacrifice is no frunk, because they took all of the electronics, the air conditioning system and everything, and really pushed it much further forward than what they would normally do in a vehicle. I'm not really concerned about that. I know a lot of people get hung up with a frunk. I don't use the frunk on my Model 3 very rarely. I've only used it a couple times. And if you're going to take that usable space and give it to me in the passenger compartment and the rear cargo area, then I'm fine with that. You know, if there's, when you engineer the car, there's room in the front to put in a frunk and you're not sacrificing anything, go for it. But if you can then replace that space with more cargo space, and I think VW did, they have 30 cubic feet of cargo space with the seats up in the back, 64 feet with the seats down. It's huge inside. I know I'm talking a lot about that, but that was my initial impression when I sat in it. For the size of the vehicle, it felt like the interior had more room than it should. And that's important, because Volkswagen wants this vehicle to be a family mover. They want this to be their, you know, high volume electric vehicle. They're actually hoping to sell hundreds of thousands of these vehicles per year. I mean, this is they literally came out and said this. They want this to be the Beetle of the 21st century. Now, I know manufacturers can say what they want and it doesn't translate to reality, but I think it has a good chance to, because it's amazingly unremarkable. But that's good, because look at the vehicles in this segment that really are the top selling vehicles, the RAV4, the Honda CR-V, the Subaru Forester. There's nothing amazing about those vehicles. They just do everything well, and they provide a tremendous amount of utility for the owners, which the ID4 is right in that wheelhouse. Now, the EPA range rating is supposed to be 250 miles. I think Volkswagen's sandbagging that a little bit. When I got in the car, it was 66% charged, and the remaining range was 176 miles. Now, that comes out to 267 miles on a full charge, which isn't that much more than 250, but this was being driven by media, and we were all punching it whenever we could, driving it hard. Now, there was some city driving which would make the range better, but we also got out of the course they gave us was taken up and down the West Side Highway, so you could really, you know, punch it a little bit, which I'm sure everybody did to feel the acceleration. And that's something that, of course, I did. I put it in sport mode. There's four driving modes: Eco, Comfort, Sport, and then there's a custom mode. And there's not a whole lot of difference of performance between those four modes. So I left it in sport mode. You have that good electric torque. It's not going to be a barn burner, this car. It's going to go 0 to 60 in like maybe 7.5 seconds, a little under 8 seconds. It only has a 201 horsepower motor. But for like, we sometimes focus too much on 0 to 60 times and quarter mile times with electric vehicles. This isn't a race car. This is a family mover. And for the vehicles it's going to compete against, those three small crossovers that I mentioned before, it's more than fast enough. You know, the regenerative braking is a little bit weaker than what I would like. When you put it in drive, the regen is very mild. You almost can't feel it. As a matter of fact, on the slow driving I was doing in the city, I couldn't feel it. But then you can push the gear shifter forward one more time and it goes into B mode, which is like the Golf, the e-Golf. It's the stronger regenerative braking mode. It's still not that strong. I know other news outlets have reported that you can do one pedal driving with it. Trust me, you can't do one pedal driving with the ID4. Maybe your version of one pedal driving, but not my version of one pedal driving, where you only need one pedal and it will roll to a stop. And the ID4 will never roll to a stop. It has artificial creep that you cannot disable. Didn't like that. And matter of fact, when I got done with my drive, the Volkswagen representatives were eager to hear feedback. They do that from all the journalists. And believe it or not, they do take your feedback. And this vehicle isn't released yet. They can make changes. So they're really anxious to hear what some of the media professionals had. And I just harped on the artificial creep. I like to the point where they're like, okay, Tom, we get what you're saying. Like, let it go, you know. And I was just like, you have to put something in the software so people can turn this off. Now, many people will want to keep it, especially a lot of the ID4 people will be first-time EV owners. They want an easy transition from the cars they're used to. Maybe they're trading in a Volkswagen Tiguan for this car, which, you know, I think you're going to see a lot of. And they're used to the car creeping forward, and they might not even realize that they would prefer it not to creep. But listen, give the people what they want. But for the people that don't want it, put something in the you know, settings where you can disable artificial creep, because it just annoys the heck out of me after driving vehicles that don't have it. So, you know, that was my biggest pet peeve. The regen isn't strong enough, in my opinion. And that's something that they could also said they could make it stronger. It's very simple software settings. But I will say that you're not wasting all of your regen possibility, because it has a blended braking system. So unlike Tesla, when you press the brake, it's also regenning. You're getting more regenerative braking until you know, if you were to press it really hard for an emergency stop, then the friction brakes are going to take over. But like the Porsche Taycan, a lot of the braking, when you use the brake pedal, is going to be regenerative braking. It's not going to be physical braking. So you don't have strong liftoff regen, but you do get strong overall regen, which is really, you know, what matters as far as being very efficient. As you can see, we got that video up there. The driver's display is attached to the top of the steering column. And I noticed when you're really low, I like a low steering wheel. First of all, I'm not very tall, but I like steering wheels that are low. When I put it all the way down to the position that I was comfortable driving, the screen was a little obstructed. The top of the screen was a little obstructed, but you know, I mean, if the screen is mounted to the dashboard and you put the steering wheel all the way up, then it could be just obstructed also. So I don't know, you know, six one way, half a dozen the other. I don't know which way is better, but I did notice that it has a shifter that is literally stolen from the BMW i3. You can see we have it up on the screen there now for those watching. So I was really comfortable with that, you know, grabbing and putting it in gear. The center display screen is really nice, crisp and clear. The infotainment system was very easy to navigate. You know, it had some good features. Again, I wish I had more time to play with it. I was just so concerned about driving it enough so I can get a feel with the car and getting good pictures, that, you know, the 45 minutes was up like it felt like 15 minutes. But hopefully we can get a longer time behind the wheel with the vehicle. Now, I will say that the reason why I think it's going to sell really well is, number one, it everything in it, while it's unremarkable, it does everything very well, what families are looking for. The price is right. with subsidies. It's going to be right in line with its competition. And Volkswagen is throwing in 3 years of unlimited charging on the Electrify America network here in the U.S. at least. Now, that's a huge savings if the dealers can communicate that properly to the customers. When you think about it, compare that to a Subaru Forester, a Honda CR-V, a Toyota RAV4. Those are the vehicles that Volkswagen's going after. They're not going after Model Y, Mustang Mach-E. They don't think that, they think that those vehicles are going to attract, for the most part, a different customer. It's a $4,000 savings if you roll the numbers with buying gas for 3 years on those vehicles if you drive 15,000 miles a year. So, you know, stack the fact that you've got the $7,500 federal tax credit. Many states have state incentives. In New Jersey here, I'd get $5,000 off the ID4 and no sales tax. So I'd get $12,500 off with no sales tax and you know, free charging for 3 years. That's another couple thousand dollar savings. Roll all those numbers in, and it's much less expensive than than its competition, and it offers more. So, you know, I think they have a winner here. I don't think they're going to sell hundreds of thousands the first year or so, but once they get their five factories around the world are going to make this vehicle. It's Volkswagen's prepping this to be a massive seller. I think once they're at their capacity and people start to realize how good of a vehicle this is, they're going to sell the heck out of them.
Right. I think a lot. Yeah, I think people are going to see, well, it's really making the switch from gas cars to electric cars for like everyone. So the people who would normally go out and just buy like the Honda HR-V, you know, they'll look at this. Hey, this is the new thing. This is what everybody else is kind of getting. And it looks different, but it's familiar enough that the change shouldn't be that dramatic. And, you know, the price is right.
It's very familiar, okay? And Volkswagen designed it to be familiar, to make it an easy transition from a gas car to an electric car. And also talking about, you know, it's not an outrageous looking vehicle. This is one of the first media drives I've done where nobody looked at me when I was driving down the road. And I was trying to see if anybody, now New Yorkers are tough and they don't like, you know, I could drive down the block in like the Herman Munster car and people probably wouldn't look, but nobody paid it. It was just a Volkswagen. And I think that was like a modern Volkswagen. And I think that plus how the vehicle, when you sit inside it, it's just like another roomy Volkswagen. Everything's easy transition. And I think to be honest with you, that's necessary for this next phase of electrification when the early majority, I mean, we're still at the end of the early adopter stage of electrification. The early majority is kind of just beginning or is going to just begin. I think for that group of people, the vehicle has to feel comfortable and it has to feel similar to what they're used to. You know, whereas the some of the early adopters and the people that were EV enthusiasts, they almost wanted something that looked different and to scream, look, I'm driving something different. I'm driving the future. But not everybody wants that. And I think Volkswagen hit it with the design and the utility of this vehicle. I think I'm certain it's going to be a winner.
Right on. Hey, so while Tom was slumming in the Volkswagen, Kyle here snagged a Polestar 1. Now, for those who are unaware, that's the brand's Halo flagship sports car. It's not an all-electric, but a plug-in hybrid. And while that's kind of disappointing for some of us, it does have some pretty impressive all-electric range. So, yeah, we don't have a whole lot of time here, but want to tell us a little bit about it, Kyle?
Sure. Polestar 1's pretty cool. So I had a Taycan. I don't know if I talked about that on last show, but we can save that for another day. I had a Taycan 4S and then the Polestar 1. Not a bad week. And the Polestar 1 is a 620 horsepower plug-in hybrid. Look at that thing. It just is the coolest shape. If you're watching in our That's YouTube sweet. Audience, you are salivating at your screen because it is a beautiful car. Every single angle of it. Look, you have... It's really hard to talk about Polestar without mentioning Volvo because it basically looks like a Volvo sports car. And that's basically what it is, just with some Polestar badges, carbon fiber, big brakes. Here are the things you need to know about this car. Big electric range. It's a plug-in hybrid. I did 62 or 65 miles, something like this, in our 70 mile per hour highway range test on a plug-in hybrid, which is something I typically do not do on plug-in hybrids because the range isn't great enough. But this was. It has 50 kilowatt fast charging, although I saw 56 kilowatt peak. It is very fast around the racetrack. We will have a one lap coming soon. It has adjustable Öhlin stampers, gold seatbelts. You know I love that. And it is just a beautiful machine. In contrast to Tom having no one look at him driving the Volkswagen, every single person looks at this car. And you know what's interesting about it? Everyone looks at you and they don't hate you. When you're the guy driving your Ferrari or whatever, you're kind of like, oh, look at this guy driving the Ferrari.
Right.
This is like so unpretentious, but so cool. And yeah, it's a beautiful place to be. It has great driver assistance. And the engine, which I know we're not an engine show, but it's a turbocharged and supercharged four-cylinder. Everything that goes into the plug-in Volvos in the US, Europeans get some of the non-supercharged ones that turn out to be plug-in hybrids. And then you have a 34 kilowatt hour battery pack that powers the rear axle. So all is really good. The software to make everything work together was nearly flawless. And they've done an amazing job on this. If you want something special, but you're the kind of guy who's a gentleman, this is the car you buy.
Or a gentlewoman. Hey, so looking at the interior there, it looks more, does it lean more towards premium or sports car from the inside?
It's not really a sports car. It's like a GT. Extremely Grand comfortable. Tour. It's the same seats that are in their Volvo V60 Polestar wagon that we tested a while ago. Maybe they're a little different, but they feel about the same. There's no perceptible difference in driving this versus a Volvo wagon. So that's what I like about it, because I love Volvo wagons. So I'm like, oh, I would just get the Volvo wagon, but that's me.
Yeah. Well, that was some pretty impressive range, though. I'm like so torn about this car. I really wish it was like all electric. I don't understand why they're doing an all electric brand, but then they start off with a plug-in hybrid. But, you know,
just because it was available off the shelf. Right. They just like went, it's Volvo's SPA chassis. What I really would have loved to see was them to take all the carbon bits out of it, because it's already really heavy, make it aluminum, and then make it 80 grand instead of 155,000. I think that would have been a better move. But you can't deny that this is just one of the, when you see one of these on the road, it's just going to be the coolest thing ever, because someone went out of their way to buy the interesting Swedish choice rather than your typical 911.
Right on. Hey, okay, so while we're on the subject of Polestar, the Polestar 2 had a bit of a disappointing week. For starters, the Polestar 2, which they just started delivering in Europe, is being recalled. All of them. In the words of the company, a software error in the battery power control module, which in very rare cases and without warning could lead to a loss of drive. So basically had a few drivers reporting their car stopping at, while they're driving, which is kind of like inopportune to say the least. So while this is not good, and we should add here also that no one has been hurt because of this, it does mean that we do know how many cars the company shipped, 2,200. So, Martin, fatal blow or just a bump in the road of an otherwise smooth rollout?
Just a bump in the road, not a fatal blow. So, yeah, that the first point was, oh, they've only sold 2,200 of these. The second point is that it has to go back because it's quite a serious update in that the car was shutting down. Steering still operates, brakes still operate, and it freewheels. So it disengages the transmission so that you can freewheel to hopefully a safe place to pull over. But clearly, this is some deep-rooted software stuff. And I was chatting to one of my listeners on my podcast who he was tongue-in-cheek saying, oh, over there, updates aren't working yet then. And I had to point out that actually, depending on which car manufacturer you're talking about, some of the over-the-air updates are more superficial. So some of them can only update the infotainment system. Some of them can only update that kind of code that isn't very deep. Others, everything. Like Tesla, can update literally all of the car, and obviously they have to then work in safety and security, because nobody wants your friendly local hacker turning your ABS off until you pay them all your bitcoins. And so the case with the Polestar is that it does have to go back to be fixed. Unfortunately, as I didn't realize talking to one of my listeners, over the air updates also aren't working yet for the Polestar. So if you own one, it will have to go back. Not all of them will, but I think some of the early ones will have to go back when they activate over-the-air updates. Also not working yet any of the mobile stuff. So right. The preheating, the charging, the scheduling, all of that stuff that you would do on an app, that isn't working yet either. That software should be ready early 2021, they say. But that won't require the car to go back to the dealer, which in the case of everywhere but the US is a Volvo dealership. So different dealer rules for you guys, but everywhere else, hopefully you've got a local Volvo dealership, hopefully not far to go back to. Hopefully you can drive the car there and get a loaner while they fix it. And fingers crossed, this has been a learning lesson for them. Although they're a new brand, a new startup, it's not like they haven't got the might of a massive company behind them with a few quid to spend. So they'll be all right.
All right. The other disappointing news from Polestar has to do with its EPA range rating, which was just released. Tom, is 233 miles or 375 kilometers good enough for a car using a 78 kilowatt hour battery, or does it do better than the EPA figure, do you think?
Well, let me backtrack really quick to the software issues. One of the points that I want to make is this just really shows how hard it is to develop robust software for electric cars. And look at the Martin had mentioned that, they're not a huge company with, a ton of weight behind them just yet. Volkswagen's a huge company, and look at the software issues they had for the ID3. So this stuff is hard. As we move towards more software driven vehicles, we're getting into an area that is automakers generally aren't as comfortable with. I mean, they're very comfortable building motors and, assembling vehicles that they buy parts from elsewhere. But the software is all in-house, and they are not as comfortable doing that. And obviously, it's harder than what many manufacturers assume. So while we beat up Tesla a lot, and Tesla still has a long way to go with, they have some software issues or whatever, I think we're seeing now like how much effort Tesla has put into their software, and the fact that big companies like Volkswagen, now we see Polestar, are having such issues with it, when they're launching their vehicles, shows just how difficult this is.
The range.
I'm not as disappointed, I think, as everybody seemed to be. Very few manufacturers are coming out and with cars that have such high efficiency. That Tesla seems to really have a good number on that, and we did a great post on that recently, kind of explained why their range is higher than most of the other manufacturers. So I mean, personally, I thought it was going to be 5 or 10 miles longer. So to me, I was pretty close to where it came in at. I mean, we just talked about the ID4. That is an 82 kilowatt hour battery, and Volkswagen's estimating 250 miles. So, okay. Which isn't that much more. So in short, I'm not overly surprised by that. And I'd like to see more evidence on the DC charging rate and curve and the time to charge. Hopefully Kyle will be able to do a demonstration of that soon, because I think that's more important, how fast it's going to charge, than the EPA range rating being 10 or 15 miles more.
True. Kyle, do you have a quick word to say about this?
Yeah, well, I was just digging through my emails, trying to find a report that I found that Polestar did themselves. And this was a really interesting thing, a US-led effort by the US Polestar team, where they rented out a track. They got a Model 3 Performance, they got an Audi e-tron, I think an I-Pace, and I don't remember the cars, but 4 or 5 different cars. And I don't know if we ever got an article up about this, but they did a 70 mile per hour highway simulated range test in a bull from 100% charge to zero. And they were able to control some more variables than we were. Of course, it was on a closed loop testing circuit. And the Polestar was less than the Model 3. I think the Model 3 did like 238 miles or something, which seems right about right for a Model 3 Performance. And the Polestar wasn't far behind, but it did better than the e-tron, and it did better than maybe it was an I-Pace they had. And I was kind of like, wow, first off, it's really cool that Polestar is very upfront with their real world range figures this test, the procedures, and it was done independently, by the way, but they did arrange it. It had nothing to do with the EPA. And I was like, okay, that's cool. And I don't remember thinking that the range was bad. I think it was only like 15 or 20 miles less than the Model 3 Performance, which is very reasonable. It's a bigger car. So I actually don't think this EPA is bad. I find it so difficult to trust EPA range ratings because we just did the Taycan last week in the 70 mile per hour test. That's rated at 203 miles EPA, this 4S. And we did 280 almost. Right. So like
277 it's just, or something.
Yeah, 277. So we're creating our own data on Inside EVs. And we're also bringing in the manufacturer supplied vehicle coast down data with the factors in wind resistance and rolling resistance. And we're going to be creating a chart with the help of some viewers that shows your predicted range at multiple different speeds based off of our 70 mile per hour test. So once we get Polestar over here, we'll put it together and see. This EPA range rating doesn't surprise me, and it's not very disappointing. It's plenty of range. What is worse is the XC40 Recharge, but that's just because it's a worse shape.
Right.
But again, it's the same car underneath, not right. a huge deal.
So yeah, as you say, so staying in the Polestar constellation, the Volvo XC, see what I did there?
That was a great, great transition.
Except I shouldn't have mentioned that. Anyway, so the Volvo XC40 Recharge P8, also has its EPA range published this week, and it's even more disappointing, as Kyle kind of mentioned. It's having a 208 mile figure attached to it going to impact sales. I mean, this is a beautiful car. You're shaking your head.
It's not going to affect anything. Look at e-tron. It's rated at 204 or something like this.
Was it?
That has a way bigger battery pack. So first off, this is at least 10 or 15% better than the Audi.
But this is lighter though, right?
Oh yeah, it's a much smaller car. Yeah. The whole thing. I mean, not a surprising difference there. But look, 200 miles EPA is fine as long as you can get at least 180 to 190 miles on the highway at 70 miles per hour. The big question here is, what does the charging curve look like? And from initial reports, it's not looking good. It's the same battery pack that's in the Polestar. We saw Bjorn do a test on it, and it tapers super early, super hard. So while that 150 kilowatts sounds nice, in actuality, you're not really getting the benefit like the Volkswagen Group cars that really charge deep into the pack. And hopefully we'll see them adjust this into the future, really try and push the cells as far as they think they can safely go, because this will be a huge thing for road trips where it just won't be feasible in a car that tapers that early.
Yeah. I mean, the XC40 is a pretty sweet car, and I really hope this doesn't like take the wind out of its sails at all. But like, as you say, I mean, if it can get close in the real world driving, if it can achieve, very close to what the EPA figure is, I think that will help a lot. Because like the e-tron, at first when it came out, there was a lot of, poo-pooing of its range, but it does pretty well. It's at 70 miles an hour. You did a test, I think it was what, or 180 something?
Yeah, 185, something like that. But the right. best part of the e-tron is your cruising ranges between chargers are 160 plus miles because it starts to taper at 80% or so. And you really charge it till you're at 90-95% each stop.
Right. So yeah, hopefully we'll see some over-the-air updates, or once they get going with the over-the-air updates, which they really need to, because that was part of the whole thing of like the polls. I'm not sure if the Android, the XC40 run on Android as well?
Yes, it'll have the Google UI, same as Polestar, right. maybe a different visual. But the XC40 is a hot topic in this household here, because right. this is what will likely replace our i3. I keep saying that. And I think Alyssa has selected the sage green color. Anyway, I think that wouldn't stop us from buying one. We're going to be in cold weather, Colorado, in mountain conditions, and she's very comfortable with the range. And keep in mind, she is not an EV techie.
Sure.
But that 200 miles, and I'm like, look, worst case, you'll probably get 150. She's like, oh, well, I don't ever have to go anywhere that far. And there's plenty of DC chargers around if she did on the off day. So I don't think it'll impact sales. It's going to be a huge success. And it's one of the best looking EVs that's coming to the market right now.
So I have a little bit of a different opinion, Kyle. I love it. I think it looks fantastic. If I was looking for that type of a vehicle, I think I would buy it. I wouldn't have reservations like you do, but we're also not the typical EV buyers. And I think people going into the Volvo dealerships, and you know, one of the things I do is I work with dealerships. I'm currently working with a couple of Volvo dealers here in New Jersey. They are not happy with the range rating. They are super concerned. And they're basically saying, you've got to tell me how I can, explain to my customers why they should buy this over a Tesla. And they said, you know, how do we compare this to Teslas that can go 400 miles per charge? Tesla's done a great messaging, like people read these news reports that Tesla Model S goes, 402 miles per charge, and that soon the Tesla's going to go 500 miles per charge. And the general public just assumes that, oh yeah, Teslas go 400 or 500 miles per charge. And now this is coming out and it goes 200 miles per charge. So, and it's basically, load this thing up, the same price as a Tesla, or more than a Model Y, but it is a bigger, nicer vehicle than a Model Y. So I think Volvo has a problem here with this. I really do. I think that it's going to really hurt the sales that it's just a 200-mile car. I think the Polestar 2 could have survived having only 200 miles of range more than the XC40 can, because it's a family mover. It's a, this has to be there when mom needs to hop in it and take the kids to soccer practice and then, go pick up, her elderly father that lives 60 miles away because he needs medicine or whatever. Like, this vehicle has to be there. It's going to be the family, the family mover. And at 200 miles, I think that it would be there, but the perception is that it's not going to be enough. People are looking at the car that they're replacing that can go 400 miles on a tank of gas and saying, geez, like, that means I have like half a tank of gas even when it's full. I think they have a problem here with that range. I really do.
Interesting. I think a lot of people, because like you were alluding to earlier, Kyle, you don't really need that range unless you're going on a road trip. So your day-to-day life, you're using what, most 120 miles. Like, if you have a crazy day and you're all over town, 100, maybe if you Uber, 150 miles. So, and that's well within that. And most people are not going to need that. I mean, unless they're street parking and, they only want to charge up, at a fast charger once every 2 weeks or something. But yeah.
Dom, the problem is we know that, but the people that are going to be buying this car don't. They're looking at 200 and they're saying, ugh, like, if this only goes 200 miles, now that's not going to work. That's how I feel about it, at least. I love it. It wouldn't stop me from buying one. I know it's not going to stop Kyle from buying one. But the Volvo people walking in that are exchanging their leases up on the XC40 and the dealer's trying to put them in this, I think they're going to have a problem with that.
Man. Well, it should be an interesting thing to keep track of, because, like you say, we know, it would work for me, but we're not the people that Volvo needs to convince, to buy it. So we're like a little over our time. So I wanted to hit a couple other stories really quick. Mercedes now sells in Europe, at least, the EQV, which is a luxury minivan type of vehicle, and the EQC, which is the electric crossover that they were going to sell in the US, and then it's not coming right away. Those will soon be joined by six new all-electric vehicles. The EQA, which is it's like an electric version of the GLA crossover. The EQB, which is slightly larger crossover, electric version of the GLB. The EQS, which is going to be a large luxury sedan. The EQE, which is kind of the same thing, but cheaper and slightly smaller than the EQS. And then SUV variants of both the EQS and the EQE, if you can keep all that straight. It's basically, one, two, four SUV crossovers and two sedans, one nicer than the other. And those are going to be on two different platforms. They also mentioned they have the electric vehicle architecture is the EVA from 2021 for large cars. So the EQS and the EQE are going to be on this EVA platform. And then later on in 2025 only. They have a new Mercedes-Benz modular architecture coming for more medium-sized vehicles, and we'll see those, you know, that's 2025, which is quite a ways out. But that's still interesting that, you know, Mercedes-Benz is a pretty prestige brand, so it looks like they are at least getting their ducks in a row eventually. They're getting there, you know. Yeah, not blowing us away with the speed of the switchover, but yeah, I guess
this was revealed in a presentation this week, an investor presentation, where they really focused on luxury and they really got the brand out there as our EVs are going to be luxury EVs, and that's smart because they can't afford to sell cheap EVs, and nor should they. So they were definitely pitching their electric cars as, we're going to be upmarket and they're going to be super luxurious and we're going to fill that gap. And that was a smart move.
Right.
But coming in 2025, that's 4 years away. Like, yeah, you know, we've got 200 of these podcasts between now and then. And like, you know what? The world's going to be different in 4 years. So,
right,
not great.
But some of these ones that are coming are on older platforms, you know, just flexible gas versions, you know. So
well, they better be luxury, because the EQV, the van, is £70,665. Now, yeah. I know that we include 20% VAT, and I can't do those maths to US dollars that quickly, right. But still,
it's a lot of money. It's
like 71 grand for a hotel shuttle bus. I mean, it's got leather seats, but it. Blimey, better come with the chauffeur for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of money.
It'd be interesting, a subscription to the EQV with a chauffeur. That would be kind of, I mean,
it comes
price.
With the chauffeur, it comes with the driver. Yeah, I like right. that.
Right. All right, so what else? Real quick, Elon Musk suggests Tesla will enter India in 2021. I think this is potentially a really big deal. India is a huge country with, you know, population, you know, right up there with China's. They haven't made the switch over to, they haven't modernized really as quickly as China has, but you know, it is what it is. But yeah, that could be a huge market, and we could see like another battery gigafactory, another gigafactory. I mean, they didn't mention that, but if the demand, you know, ends up being anywhere near what China has, man, it's going to be nuts. So that could be a huge story, something to keep an eye on. Lucid Motors has opened up its first standalone showroom and service center in Beverly Hills. That's kind of nice. If you want to check out is that open, Tom?
Yes, it opened last week. So that's actually their second showroom. They have one in Newark, California, which was opened in March. But this is their first standalone showroom. They're going to have 20 by the end of 2021.
Nice. But you need an appointment or something to go there, right?
Due to COVID restrictions, they're asking that you make an appointment. So I have a feeling if you showed up and knocked on the door, they wouldn't tell you to leave.
Right. So if you're anywhere near Beverly Hills and you want to check out the new Lucid Air, there you go. There's a shop to give them a ring and arrange to see that. Also, this is really exciting for me because I like commercial vehicles and trucks. So Rivian's first Amazon electric delivery van has been out driving. Amazon introduced it formally to the public on their blog. And we have a video up on the site. You can see some of the driver's reactions to it. We can see it rolling down the road like it's a real vehicle. Amazon has ordered like 100,000 of these things. So eventually we should see like a lot of them. And I think it's a sweet looking ride. And as John Neff, our Motor One editor in chief, was saying, he wants to see like an RV based on this, which, you know, I think it'd make a great platform for that as well. But I think that's going to be a little ways out. But yeah. And let's see, one last note. So the Mitsubishi iMiEV, or iMiEV, depends on how you pronounce it, is going to end production soon. Pouring one out. This thing has been along forever. Actually, I didn't realize it was still being made. I'm not even sure. Maybe Martin can tell us where they're selling this.
That's the biggest shocker here, is that they've still been making
Where do they sell this, Martin?
Where do they sell? Oh, yeah, I think you can still buy one here. Yeah, I think you can still buy one here.
Okay.
I was as surprised as you are that they're going to stop production. I'd presumed it had stopped already. This is you know, to come full circle, what Tom said earlier about some EVs early on in the EV world were loved for their quirkiness.
Yes.
A lot of early EV adopters hold this as a very dear place in their heart, maybe even in their EV story if they owned one, but won't be sad to see it go. I'm glad we're moving on the EV curve to not this.
Man.
That's a great way of putting it.
I have a soft spot in my heart for this thing because it was like one of the first ones, you know, and like I remember just scrounging for stories, you know, about 10 years ago or so, looking for, you know, stories about electric vehicles for people to read because people were hungry for it. And, you know, it was like 100 different stories about Miev showing up in different markets, like a little Caribbean island here or New Zealand or, you know, in the US, this is a little bit different looking. It has a, they attached like this weird front bumper thing to it to so it pass our crash standards. So it looks kind of even weirder in the US. And it's not super quick. It is a rear-wheel drive, which is kind of neat. And it has a motor in the back. There's some really cool things. I'm really sad that Mitsubishi didn't really, you know, lean into this and develop it. And they should, you know, Mitsubishi just still has what they have. They have the plug-in hybrid SUV. What's that called?
The Outlander, which no
right,
one
but it's popular in the UK, right, Martin?
It is the number one plug-in hybrid in this country,
and in Norway they sell a ton.
They're pulling out, so they're not going to develop more versions of it for at least the UK market, if not Europe. So one of those brands that we see, Mitsubishi, Subaru, big question mark over their head as well, because they just sell, well, they sell so few cars, but just these brands that don't want to develop an electric future, looking at the markets they sell their cars in and saying, easier to pull the plug than try and do a compliance car.
I think the whole economic situation from like 2008 or 2009, I think that really did a number on Mitsubishi. They almost died there, but you know, they really stopped a lot of their development. A lot of their US dealer network shut down, disappeared, and they've been trying to claw their way back. And you know, it's hard, and everything's changing, so it's, you know, doubly hard. But yeah, well,
it's amazing that they've still hung on this long, because I think their TVs, they should stick to that and just let the cars go.
Well, man. I have a soft spot for them, but they really don't do. I'd have a hard time getting myself to, you know, go into a dealership and buying one. Though sometimes
they had such a good thing with the Evo, then they canceled it, and now they have nothing interesting.
Yeah,
and this is definitely not interesting.
No,
is whatever this thing is.
10 years ago, it was.
You know, I'm gonna blow one of these up on the YouTube channel. So I'm sorry to everyone who likes these cars. One will end up in flames very soon on the Out of Spec Motoring channel.
We need an off-road race with a smart EV.
Maybe we should just send it into a big fiery gas burning fire and just have a nice explosion. But still, the smart would be faster off-road anyway.
Okay. Yeah, well, it is kind of pokey, the iMove. So anyway, that brings us to the end of our show. Yes, we're way over time. Thank you all for joining us. And if you have any comments about any of the topics on today's show, you can comment on the Inside EVs podcast post, the YouTube comment section below, or on the Inside EVs forum podcast thread. Don't forget, you can find and follow our panelists on Twitter. Tom is at Tomalog. Martin is at EV News Daily. Kyle is at Out of Spec, and I'm at Dominic_Y. Click subscribe and tap that bell icon for notifications so you get a heads up when all our new videos are coming out. The charging videos are 70 mile an hour range tests, and we'll see you all next week. Ciao.